Hello everyone, this is group G29 and we are working on the problem of heat transfer in an engine room. Our user story is about the marine engineers who work in the engine room of a ship and experience high heat stress due to constant heat emissions by the main and auxiliary engines. Along with this, the humid ambient air causes excessive sweating and the engineer has to change his uniform 2 to 3 times per shift. We want to design a system so as to reduce the inlet air temperature and the humidity before the air enters the engine room. The engine room has many components, but the two main things that contribute to the immense heat is the main engine and the boiler. The main engine reaches a temperature of about 60 degrees and a boiler which is used to produce steam is also at a very high temperature. The current system used to cool the main engine is the water jacket cooling system, in which fresh water is fed in a jacketed cooling around the main engine. But what we are aiming at is to reduce the inlet air temperature itself so that there is the temperature of the engine room itself reduces. So our proposed solutions are to make modifications to the existing boiler suit so that the marine engineer working there is more comfortable. And second one is to make a heat exchanger system that reduces the inlet air temperature and also eliminates humidity from it. This solution consists of three parts, mainly the dehumidifier, cooling unit and a concentric heat exchanger. Now let us look at each one of these solutions in detail.
It is extremely hot in the engine room and marine workers who work there have to stay an extended part of time. To ease their stay, we have come up with different measures, boiler suit being first of them. We have started out by finding out how effective an ordinary cotton cloth is in providing insulation. Further, we have searched for alternative fabrics, a fabric which shows maximum result in acting as an insulant by keeping the optimum body temperature. The CV diagram is mentioned below. The heat transfer is carried out by conduction between the skin and the boiler suit. Further, it is carried out by radiation and convection between boiler suit and the surroundings. The surrounding air temperature is considered to be 323 Kelvin. It is very high because of the presence of an engine, heat producing engine. Further, the total contact surface area is taken to be 1.8 meter square and the heat transfer coefficient of air is 2 watt per meter square Kelvin. Here, the radiation is modeled like convection. We have linearized the radiation rate equation, meaning now it is directly proportional to the temperature difference rather than earlier to difference between two temperatures raised to the fourth power. HR is calculated by the equation which is given here. To find TF, we have to solve iteratively and therefore we have taken the initial value TI as 308 Kelvin, which is one of the knowns. Therefore, we can conclude that the final temperature TF is 315.14 Kelvin, which is approximately 5 degrees higher than the optimum body temperature. Optimum body temperature being 310 Kelvin or 36.5 to 37 degrees Celsius. Also, plotting this TF equation and the HR equation in a graph, we vary the epsilon, K and L, which are the variations of a particular fabric. We find out that an higher conductivity, a lower emissivity and a least thickness leads to less skin temperature. Point to be remembered is that although K, Epsilon and L are only that, we know the relation of K, Epsilon and L to the final temperature, we browse through few research papers to obtain the desired material and the conclusion we had got was thermal conductivity and thermal resistance of fabric increases with the increase in fabric density. We find that nylon will have a better performance compared to other fibers for the process of human body cooling. The L, Epsilon and K values of nylon is given. It is less thick than cotton, has an higher Epsilon and K value. The TF also is hence 4.5 degrees less than that of cotton and 310.7 Kelvin is approximately closer to the optimal body temperature of 36.5 to 37 degrees Celsius. Though we have been able to see a considerable success numerically, our way forward.
So as we had mentioned earlier, our thermotrap consists of three problems. Part A is a dehumidifier unit, part B is a cooling unit and part C is a heat exchanger. Let's look at the flow of air inside the thermotrap. So ambient air enters the air dehumidifier where the moisture is absorbed by the adsorbent particles. This then travels to the cooling unit where the air is cooled using a suitable coolant and then it passes on into the engine room. So for the dehumidifier unit we had two options. We could have used a desiccant dehumidifier or we could have used a condenser. So in this solution, we have gone with the desiccant dehumidifier because of a few advantages that it has over a condenser. A condenser has a dependence on its environment. For example, the temperature of the coolant must be lower than the surrounding temperature for the water to condense. Whereas desiccant dehumidifier is heavily dependent on the desiccant materials. This makes it more efficient to use in places like the seas where the temperatures vary a lot during the day and night and during the storms and in the Middle Eastern areas. Other advantage that a desiccant dehumidifier has is that it is self-reliant. It can desorb and adsorb easily. So the mechanism for our desiccant dehumidifier is: the cool air enters the dehumidifier from the ambience. It passes through a filter panel to get rid of any dust that might accumulate in the desiccant material later. This air then passes through the adsorption tube, which is filled with desiccant material. This desiccant material is dry and it absorbs a lot of moisture from the air. Now this air then passes through another filter panel and is ejected into the cooling unit. Our desiccant dehumidifier is self-reliant. When the air is demoisturized from one tube, that is adsorption tube 1 in the diagram, it goes to a piston valve. Here a fraction of the dry air is again recirculated inside the other adsorption tube 2 in our diagram. This has saturated wet desiccant material. This air then dries out the desiccant material and exits from the tube. Thus, the damp desiccant is dried. When desiccant in tube 1 reaches saturation, the first piston valve changes the airflow from tube 1 to tube 2 and the same process repeats. Thus, when one tube is dry, the other becomes wet, and when one becomes wet, the other becomes dry. While finding an ideal desiccant material, we went through a lot of desiccant particles. We found silica gel, activated alumina and molecular sieves to be the most effective. To gain maximum effectiveness, we found out a desiccant material which had activated alumina, a silicon dioxide, iron oxide and Na2O. The detailed properties and different sizes and the chemical composition of this desiccant material is given in the report.
For cooling the inlet air, we use the design of a cooling unit which uses the principle of a cross-flow heat exchanger, in which we take the coolant as fresh water. We aim to achieve a lowering of 10 degrees Celsius in the temperature of the inlet air. The design parameter of our problem, or the unknown in our problem, is the length of the heat exchanger tubes, which we will find using heat transfer analysis of the system. The system consists of 60 tubes with 6 rows and each row consisting of 10 tubes. The schematic diagram is as shown. We have also insulated the outer box of the cooling unit to minimize the heat loss to the surroundings. We will be using it as a control volume for the energy balance. We know that the temperature of the inlet and outlet air are 30 degrees and 20 degrees Celsius respectively, and we also know that the inlet temperature of the coolant or water is 16 degrees Celsius. We find the outlet temperature of water using energy balance. The terms neglected in the energy balance are due to the assumptions of insulated system, no reactions, no work and steady state. The outlet temperature of water was found out to be 16.25 degrees Celsius using this analysis. We plot the temperature profiles for water and the air streams. The slope of the air curve is steeper than the slope of the water curve due to the higher specific heat of water than air. After this, we estimate the heat fluxes due to the different modes of heat transfer. We find that the heat flux due to conduction and radiation are significantly smaller than the heat flux due to convection. Due to this, we neglect the heat flux due to conduction and radiation and only consider heat transfer due to convection. The Reynolds number in the inner flow for the inner flow is estimated to be greater than 10,000. So
For finding the inner heat transfer coefficient, we use the Nusselt number correlation for flow through circular tubes, which is shown on the left. For the outer heat transfer coefficient, we use the Nusselt number correlation for flow across banks, which is shown on the right. The calculated values are also shown. Now, we combine this and estimate the overall heat transfer coefficient by also taking into account the resistance due to the pipe and the fouling factors. The heat exchanged can be found out by multiplying the mass flow rate times the specific heat of air and the temperature difference between the inlet and outlet streams of air. This can be equated to the overall heat transfer coefficient times the total area times the log mean temperature difference. On solving these two equations, we find out the length of the tube, which comes out to be 1.36 meters, which is quite feasible in the ship.
Once we were done with the drying and cooling of air, we encountered another problem. Have a look at this diagram again. After absorbing heat from the inlet air, the coolant now has a higher temperature. Since the freshwater coolant will go back to the water jacket cooling system, where it was initially taken from, it will reach a temperature of approximately 35 degrees Celsius again. To reuse this fresh water in the cooling unit, we need to lower its temperature back to 16 degrees Celsius. So we designed a heat exchanger that uses deep sea water, which is available at approximately 6 degrees Celsius, to lower the fresh water temperature. For solving this problem, we took a coaxial concentric heat exchanger. In this heat exchanger, seawater passes through the inner pipe while fresh water passes through the annulus in the opposite direction. We took the diameters as 40 mm and 60 mm respectively. The inlet temperature of fresh water coming from the water jacket cooling system is at 35 degrees Celsius, while the deep sea water temperature is at 6 degrees Celsius. Since in the cooling unit, the inlet temperature of fresh water coolant was 16 degrees Celsius, we have taken the exit temperature as the same. We want to find the length of the heat exchanger. So first we calculated the required heat transfer rate and water outlet temperature. For inner tube, we calculated the Reynolds number and it came out to be in the turbulent region. For annulus, we did the same and got the Reynolds number in laminar region. Then we applied the appropriate Nusselt correlations to find their heat transfer coefficients. Then we calculated the overall heat transfer coefficient considering the fouling factors. Using all this, we got the length to be approximately 35 meters. This length is feasible on ships which are normally about 300 to 450 meters long. All the detailed calculations are mentioned in the report.
Marine engineers experience harsh climate during their voyages due to the extreme heat produced by the engines. Hence, at the start of the project, we set out to better their environments. On the completion of this project, we were able to achieve a reduction of approximately 4.5 degrees in the boiler suit made of nylon compared to cotton. 2. Humidity is a major cause of sweating, and we, through dehumidifier, was able to reduce the humidity of ambient air before injecting into the engine room. 3. Through thermotrap, we were able to reduce the temperature of inlet air by 10 degrees Celsius, which reduces the temperature and the heat stress caused to the engineers, hence providing a better comfortable environment to them. Therefore, although we have achieved success numerically on paper, we wish our way forward is to provide these results practically as well. We thank the professors for this wonderful opportunity.